in the aftermath of a powerful and several month-long volcanic eruption a mere 938 years ago in the United States, a 142-square-mile swath of land was made essentially lifeless, as this represented the area covered by more than a foot thick of volcanic ash, with a smaller area closer to the volcanic vent which erupted coated by as much as 20 feet thick of ash. What remained within the broader region was the charred remnants of a thick pine forest, having been largely burned to the ground by the heat of advancing lava flows, which covered 3 square miles of ground and were still semi-molten a few weeks after the eruption ended. In this devastated landscape, there were even still steaming pyroclastic flow deposits, having been produced by superheated currents 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit in temperature that traveled more than 1.5 miles from the erupting vent, incinerating everything in their path. Several thousand native people fled the area due to this eruption, who witnessed towering eruption plumes from far away as they reached up to 66,000 feet above sea level, blocking out the sun. While it might sound like what I am describing is the ancient aftermath of a lesser-known yet powerful explosive volcanic eruption of Mount St. Helens, or perhaps another stratovolcano which has produced Plinian eruptions such as Mount Edgecombe in Alaska, this is surprisingly not the case, as this eruption did not originate from a U.S. state directly bordering a section of the Pacific Ocean, but rather the interior of Arizona. This eruption occurred not from a stratovolcano, but rather, quite strangely, a cinder cone north of the modern town of Flagstaff, which is today called Sunset Crater. States ranging from eastern California and the Mojave Desert to New Mexico, Utah, Nevada, and Arizona altogether consist of more than 1,000 cinder cones, which have erupted in the last 6 million years. These vents all erupted once and then never erupted again, occurring in numerous different monogenetic volcanic fields. Cinder cones are the most predictable type of volcanic vent, as they almost all produce moderate ash emissions, lava fountains, medium-length lava flows, and intermittent strombolian explosions, which throw bombs of rock in a several thousand-foot radius. Thus, for most erupting cinder cones around the planet, supposing deadly gas was not blowing in your direction, and you weren't close to recent or active lava flows, you could, in my opinion, generally stand a mile away from the erupting vent and be completely safe. These eruptions are almost always strombolian in nature, like seen during the 2021 eruption of Cumbre Vieja on the island of La Palma, although sometimes cinder cone-forming eruptions also contain weak volcanic components to them. Yet, they are generally considered only moderately explosive eruptions not involving pyroclastic flows and generally creating an eruption column no more than 10,000 feet in height while also having a volcanic explosivity index of a 1 or 2. Yet, the 1085 CE eruption of Sunset Crater was 2 orders of magnitude more explosive than a typical cinder cone-forming eruption, as it had a volcanic explosivity index of a 4, created pyroclastic flows, and up to 66,000-foot-high eruption column, and ejected 0.28 cubic kilometers of tephra. So, why was Sunset Crater the most explosive cinder cone in existence, having eruptive features similar to the most explosive of stratovolcanoes? You might think that this explosiveness was owed to the viscosity of the lava, as more silica-rich lavas such as dacite and rhyolite are generally created in far more explosive eruptions than those of less silica-rich lavas such as basalt and picrobasalt. Yet, Sunset Crater only erupted a traditionally non-explosive rock type known as basalt, but was also far more explosive than a young cinder cone known as Espy Crater, which erupted a more viscous type of lava known as basaltic andesite. Instead, a completely separate factor caused Sunset Crater to be the planet's most explosive cinder cone, even producing a sub-plinian eruption phase, as the eruption involved an absurdly high amount of gas, specifically carbon dioxide and sulfur dioxide. The more volatiles and gas a volcanic eruption has, the more explosive it will be. Sunset Crater's source magma was not only unusually gas-rich, but at a depth of approximately 10 miles, the carbon dioxide bubbles were already coming out of solution, causing the molten rock to shoot upwards at a high rate as these gases expanded at shallower and shallower depth. Additionally, this magma melted through several limestone units which released significant amounts of carbon dioxide. This gas expansion caused the magma conduit to repeatedly disintegrate and expand on its edges, creating an abundant supply of already pulverized rock for the eventual eruption. All of this allowed for pyroclastic flows and an unusually tall eruption column to be generated. As a final note, I would like to thank my new patron, Barrett Keller, for supporting this channel.